Hello class, in this video tutorial we'll be talking about antigenic shift and antigenic drift. So what are antigenic drift and shift? So do not confuse antigenic drift with the genetic drift, because they are different things. Because antigenic drift and antigenic shift, both of the terms are from the immunological perspective and from the infection perspective of viruses most of the time. Because viruses are certain things which can change and shift between their surface receptors very, very fast. One such example is influenza virus. As you know, influenza, different types of influenza strains are coming out every year, every time, and they're infecting us, and we don't have the immunity to fight against them. The reason behind them is this genetic, the antigenic drift and the antigenic shift. So what are these two things? So let's look at the very beginning, what is the difference between the drift and shift? In a nutshell. So if you look at here, let's say this is a virus. Now the virus have different types of surface receptor molecules, surface protein molecules. Those molecules, in case of influenza or other strains of flu viruses, have hemagglutinin and neuraminidase. Among those substances, like hemagglutinins, are very important for the virus to interact with the host cell and start the infection. So let's see here, these are the presence of hemagglutinins in purple color shown here. Now let's say, due to certain reasons, if the virus change the type of hemagglutinin that is present onto the surface of the virus, it can produce a different type of different substrain of the virus. Not the change in complete strain, but still it may change the type of hemagglutinin spike that is present outside. Because if you look the structure of influenza virus, it is filled with spikes, hemagglutinin and neuraminidase spike. So here let's say sometimes what happens, the polymerase of the virus, the DNA polymerase for the virus, may change that thing into some different kind of. So due to the small mutation in the hemagglutinin, they change the hemagglutinin spike type. Now this may change how this hemagglutinin is going to interact with the host cell. For example, let's say previously for this same type of infection, antibody was present in the host cell to prevent and coat the hemagglutinin. Those antibodies are called as neutralizing antibody. But now, due to the change in the structure and behavior of hemagglutinin, those antibodies will no longer be functional. As a result, these viruses can bind with those host receptor and cause infection. Now, on the other hand, if you look at the genetic shift, it occurs in much more larger scale. For example, let's say there are three different strains of viruses with having different types of hemagglutinins in the surface: green, purple and yellow. Now the thing here, in case of genetic shift, a shift occurs. That means what happens, let's say a particular cell is infected by two or three different types of the viruses, two or three different strain of the same viruses. Now those viruses can exchange the genetic material between them, and they combine those materials with each other to produce a combinatory virus, complete new strain of virus. For example, in this case, it produces a strain containing all the three kinds of hemagglutinin spike onto the surface. And this type of virus is much more stronger, because the antibody against this virus will not be effective all the time. So a complete new strain is generated in genetic shift. But in genetic drift, small mutation occurs, but not the change in strain. So let's look at the antigenic drift in detail. Let's say this is a virus. This is a virus, the capsid and the genetic content of the virus is drawn here. And this virus is having the H, which is the hemagglutinin. Now let's say this is a person. So the first person, say person P, which is having a receptor onto the surface, which will actually attach with the hemagglutinin spike there. But before they interact with this hemagglutinin, there are certain antibody that is present in the person P's blood, which are coating the hemagglutinin. As you can see here, they are denoted with the green and the blue colored structure of the antibody. So as they cover the hemagglutinin, this virus may not interact with the surface ligand onto the surface of this person P's body, and the person will be safe. Now the problem here, let's say due to some reason, let's say one reason of this is a failure mechanism, any means of any mutation if takes place inside there. If by means of any mutation take place, as you can see here, now the virus, having a virus star or V star, now as you can see here, one of the strands is now yellow in color, small section of it is yellow. That means there is a mutation going on there. Due to this mutation, the hemagglutinin spike is also being changed. So as this spike being changed, now Now let's say this problem or this process occur in another person's body, let's say person Q, because the thing is viruses cannot stay outside a host, so the only way virus can survive is inside a living host. That's why definitely it needs to carry out all the processes in another person, and here is the person P, person Q. Now once that virus acquired the mutation in person Q body, then the virus can come out again. Once the virus come out and re-attacks the person P, this time the hemagglutinin region is modified and it can interact with the ligand present in the cell surface for person P, and the antibodies are no longer be functional in this case. So in this case they can cause this infection again, which was previously prevented by neutralizing antibodies, but now they don't, they are unable to do that. So this thing always works, and that's how antigenic drift takes place. If you look at the mechanism of how antigenic drift takes place, the reason is a small mutation or accumulation of mutations. The reason behind that, let's say this is a virus, the spikes are coming out. Now somehow, let's say one example that I'm going to show you here is let's say the virus polymerase enzyme, the DNA polymerase for the virus or RNA polymerase for the virus, that polymerase have a somehow add a erroneous nucleotide sequence during the translation, during the DNA replication process, during the copy of genetic segment of the virus. As a result, what it produces, different variety, as you can see, it produces different varieties of virus. That same virus with the genetic material slightly modified in some place, and it changes the expression of different types of hemagglutinin spike as well as neuraminidase spike. So now they generate different kind of substrain kind of viruses. They can attack different individuals. Now if you want to look at the antigenic shift, now what is antigenic shift? We have already talked about antigenic shift before. So usually what we've seen here in antigenic shift previous video is that antigenic shift is accumulation of different types of genetic material inside the same virus. For example, let's say this is the scenario with a cell, secondary host for example. That secondary host has a different surface receptor for a virus and two different strain of the virus, a human, another avian strain of that same virus. Now the same virus for the human and avian strain is attacking that secondary host with the help of the hemagglutinin spike, denoted here with this red as well as blue coloration here. So once they involve in the interaction, and then the virus is inside, virus replicates its DNA materials, and once the replication is done, then all those different types of DNA segment, the genetic segment between the human genome as well as avian genome, start to recombine between themselves, and the virus particle will come out by cracking the cell open. So once the virus particle is outside, now you can see an important thing takes place during the assembly of the new progeny phage, because during the assembly of the new progeny virus particle here, it combines with both the type of genetic material, one from the human, another from the avian. Now the thing is, as this virus is modified, it now carries both the gene of human as well as avian virus strain. Now it contains a slight modification. It gets certain types of modification in the hemagglutinin as well as neuraminidase spike. Now this is a change in the genome in 50-50% ratio, and this change completely changes the strain of that virus. And now that virus can go and interact with the human cell. It can attack the human cell, and the human cell antibody which was developed previously by the any other type, the human strain, will not work now, because now this virus is not only having the genome to infect human, but also they have the genome from the avian strain. So a complete different strain of virus is originated. That's the dangerous part of antigenic shift. Now what is the mechanism of antigenic shift? If you look at here, let's say this is one strain of virus, H3N2 virus. Now what are the names regarding H and N? H means hemagglutinin, N means neuraminidase. So there are different combinations of hemagglutinin and neuraminidase spike is possible. So this is H3N2. Let's remind that all of them are having 8 RNA segments among them. So RNA viruses, let's say. Now we have another strain, H5N1 virus. All of these are flu virus, and the example of how flu virus is so much versatile, how flu virus is producing more and more strains day by day, and very very fast. Actually this evolution is much much faster than we actually think. So these are the conditions that H3N2 and H5N1, once they come close to each other, and if they cross the barrier of a cell and insert inside the cell, cross the barrier, that is the cell membrane. Now both the genetic materials for H3N2 and H5N1 are mixed in the cell, inside the cell. Now here comes an important point. Now once they will be replicated, and then finally once the virus start to assemble, there comes the important stage. So here another fact, that the, during the time of virus assembly, what may result here is that some part from this hemagglutinin 5 of the second virus genome will be taken along with the part of the neuraminidase 2. So as a result, it can be a combination of either type, like H5N2. So the combinations H3N1. So these are the two different variety, new variety that is possible. And if you look at here, there will be a mix between the genetic material of H5N1 and H3N2. And we have a combination of hemagglutinin 5 from the second one and the neuraminidase 2 from the first one. And it's not like that it contain only hemagglutinin. It should have hemagglutinin and neuraminidase. So the combinations, the new combinations that are possible here is one H5N2, another one is the H3N1. So in this case, let's say H5 and N2 combines and they produces a completely different and new strain of virus expressing completely new type of hemagglutinin and neuraminidase onto their surface. Now this is a completely different strain. It can interact and attack different types of individuals, and the antibody that was developed previously will not be functional anymore. So that's how the genetic shift works. And if you like the video, please don't forget to subscribe, hit the subscribe button, like this video, and also share this with your social media friends. So that's it, guys. Thank you.